Good morning. Good morning, everyone. All graduates of the Duke University School of Nursing, families and friends, special welcome to today's speaker, Secretary of North Carolina Department of Health and Human Services, Cody H. Kingsley, and also a special welcome to Dr. Mary Ann Fuchs, Vice President of Patient Care and System Chief Nurse Executive for Duke University Health System. Welcome to additional leaders and distinguished guests from the Duke University Health System and Duke University, and Duke University School of Nursing students, faculty, staff, and alumni joining us here at the Duke University Chapel, and to all of those that are attending today via online that could not be here in the chapel today, welcome. I am Vincent Kiyama Ramos, Dean of the Duke University School of Nursing and Vice Chancellor for Nursing Affairs at Duke University. On behalf of DUSON, it is a pleasure to welcome you to the Duke University School of Nursing Winter 2022 Hooding and Recognition Ceremony. Graduates, we are so proud of you and your achievements. Today actually recognizes a very special milestone. Our 100th Women's Health Nurse Practitioner is graduating in this class today, which is something that we celebrate as a school. We look forward to seeing how you will contribute to the improvement of our country's health and advance the future of healthcare through nursing. Thank you to the family, friends, and supporters of our graduates that join us here today. Every graduate could not have made it to this point without your encouragement and support. I'd also like to thank our DUSON faculty and staff for helping our students achieve their professional goals and create meaningful experiences and memories. A special thank you to our Office of Student Services for coordinating today's ceremony. And thank you to our organist, Chad Fothergill, and harpist, Laura Byrne, for adding to this special day. It is now my great honor to introduce today's speaker for our Winter 2022 Hooding and Recognition Ceremony address, North Carolina Secretary of Health and Human Services, Cody H. Kingsley. Cody Kingsley was appointed in 2022 as North Carolina's Secretary of Health and Human Services by Governor Roy Cooper and confirmed unanimously by the North Carolina Senate. Secretary Kingsley's department has responsibility for supporting the health and well-being of all North Carolinians, achieved through over 18,000 staff and a budget of approximately $26 billion. Secretary Kingsley's experience is centered on health policy and operations. Prior to his current role, Secretary Kingsley worked on the digital transformation of healthcare at the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. In addition, he crafted national education and labor policies at the White House. And Secretary Kingsley was appointed by the President to serve as the Chief Operating Officer and Chief Financial Officer of the U.S. Treasury. As Secretary of North Carolina Department of Health and Human Services, Kingsley has prioritized three areas of focus for the department: promoting behavioral health and resilience, growing child and family well-being, and building a strong and inclusive workforce. Today, Secretary Kingsley will address the role of nurses in supporting these three priority areas. On a personal note, Secretary Kingsley grew up in Wilmington, North Carolina, earned his bachelor's degree from Brevard College and his master's of public policy from the University of California at Berkeley. Please join me in welcoming the Secretary of the North Carolina Department of Health and Human Services, Cody H. Kingsley.
Hello, graduates. Hello, family members and friends. Congratulations to you, your family, your friends, your loved ones on achieving such a significant milestone. It's an honor to be here with you today. I'd like to thank Dean Ramos for the invitation to be here. I have found him to be a passionate and thoughtful and innovative leader, committed not only to advocating for and advancing the nursing profession, but he's deeply committed to serving North Carolinians and everyone in need of better access to care. This, of course, cannot be done without the stellar faculty here at the Duke School of Nursing. They both create and disseminate knowledge. But perhaps, and most importantly, they are the caretakers of the future of the nursing profession, each of you. Each of you are the embodiment of the future of nursing, the future of healthcare, and the promise of a healthier North Carolina and world. I'm going to say North Carolina a lot, and spoiler alert, because I want you all to stay here forever. I'm grateful to be here with you today, not just because I like a good celebration, but also because coming together to celebrate and to gather with friends and family is a part of being human. We need this. It is something that we have missed for the last several years. We worked hard to protect ourselves and the people around us, and above all, we ensured that those who did get sick had the available care that they needed. And I can give you a number. North Carolina's overall hospital capacity never passed 91% at the height of the pandemic. That was incredibly hard work. But this is a story best told firsthand in terms of patients and their families. Those of you graduating from the Accelerated Bachelor of Science in Nursing signed up during COVID. You heard about the sick patients, the full hospitals, and the challenges across the health system. And you stepped up and said, pick me. I want to help. And after I bet was a grueling 16 months with almost 800 hours in clinic, you're ready. Thank you. Those of you with the master's and doctorate programs know that the patients and families went through. You lived the rigors and the challenges and the heartbreaks of COVID. And you decided to learn more so that you could give more and make a bigger difference in the lives of patients. Whether you are going on to a leadership role or specialized care in one of 9 different areas or holding yourself to a higher standard, I applaud your work and your dedication. I remember sitting where you were twice. First, when I received my undergraduate degree at Brevard, as Vincent mentioned, I had no idea that sitting out there that one day I would be standing here before you. But career paths are never linear, and the best ones don't play out how we planned them. More on that later. I wound my way from Brevard to a job running operations at a behavioral health provider in Western North Carolina, and then pit stops at the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services and the White House and the U.S. Treasury, all to come full circle back to Health and Human Services here in North Carolina. It was quite a boomerang, and I was sure that there was going to be no more surprises. And then COVID. And here our shared experience begins to merge. Starting with the quest for PPE, tests, and treatment, we welcome the miracle of vaccines, shots of hope. When we thought the tide was turning, Delta. And we thought when we were done with that, Omicron. We watched the numbers spike time and time again. We figured it out only to figure out that we were wrong. We had to keep working. But as the Omicron wave subsided, there was hope. And hope that the right tools would allow us to manage COVID so it didn't manage us going forward. We built on that concept and in March released a plan of moving forward together. We emphasized 3 priorities for building back stronger from the pandemic, for improving the health and well-being and safety of North Carolinians. The priorities are investing in behavioral health and resilience, supporting child and family well-being, and building a strong and inclusive workforce. These top priorities are grounded in whole person health, driven by equity, and rooted in the lessons learned responding to a health crisis not seen in 100 years. Let me talk about behavioral health and resilience. The pandemic has not been easy. We've all experienced isolation and uncertainty and grief in ways that we could not have imagined. We've heard a lot about self-care. And ASBN graduates, I understand that you've heard a lot about self-care in your training, over and over and over again. But it's true what the airlines say. You have to put your oxygen mask on before assisting others. We know what a profound impact behavioral health has had on health overall. The pandemic had an impact on both. Anxiety rose during the pandemic, drug and alcohol use rose during the pandemic, deaths from drug overdoses up during the pandemic, and on and on and on. So on one side of the overall health equation, we had a new infectious disease that was impacting our physical health. And on the other side, it was also impacting our mental health as well, as was many of the movements that we were having to make to control COVID. As we move forward and as you move forward into your new roles and new training, know that the Department of Health and Human Services is here to support you and supporting a system that will support you. We are committed to increasing access to services, promoting prevention, and normalizing conversations about mental health. And that means working with mental and behavioral health providers to meet people where they're at, figuratively and literally. Using mobile mental health clinics to reach people in communities, the launch of 988, a new 3-digit dial number that allows people to connect to service providers in crisis. It's services like these that help increase access to care and will break the stigma of seeking help, which barriers for so many. When it comes to breaking down stigma, you will be the ones to make this happen. You've learned to ask about food and housing and transportation. You know to leave space for others to talk about what's really going on. And you recognize that they're not just tired and they're not just going through a phase. But these are issues that can be treated, and the faster that we reach them, the faster we can move forward. Behavioral health is a priority whose actions address many different groups, and our second priority ties in closely to this, child and family well-being. It concentrates on the needs of children and families to help them grow and thrive. We want every child in North Carolina to grow up safe, healthy, and thriving in a nurturing environment. That starts with everyone working together. We've charted a course around a coordinated action plan that envisions child welfare that is community-based, that serves people as much as possible in home and in a preventative manner. Our third priority is close to all of your hearts. Graduates, friends, and family, and faculty, and leadership too. A strong and inclusive workforce. For nearly 3 years, our caregiving workforce, all of you, you showed up to every challenge. I see your sacrifices and those of your family members. When they needed you to be there, you were there for us. And now is the time for us to be there for you. And that's why it has to be a top priority for all of us to build a strong and inclusive workforce. We cannot be healthy and well in this country without a strong workforce that looks like, comes from, and has lived the experiences of everyone else in the country. And it holds true for the other side of the coin. Good health is essential to ensuring both productive and effective workers. We have an opportunity to make lasting change by investing in the better health of North Carolinians. These workforce challenges did not happen overnight, and it will take all of us working together to improve it. What does this mean for nurses working pediatric intensive care or providing cancer care or leading others who provide that care? First, as you've done in your education, we have to start with equity. It is a lesson that my team at the department learned firsthand and in so many ways, time and time again, during the COVID-19 pandemic. Equity matters. The words you choose matter. Who speaks them matter. We learn the importance of working within communities rather than coming in from on high. You've also seen that firsthand at Duke. You know that marginalized populations experience some challenges that significantly impact their health outcomes. If they can't afford fruits and vegetables and other nutritious foods, then they can't have a healthy diet. If someone is homeless, then their first thought is not going to be taking their medications on time. And you've learned that race, ethnicity, and sexual orientation all have an impact on whether someone seeks care in the first place. Being able to name the problem is the first step. Being able to quantify it is even better. And I know that quantitative methods are really important, and those of you who finish your doctorate degrees, I've heard that you all love statistics. I'm here to tell you that there are people who love quantifying all of these data points, and analyzing them and reporting them. Stories are powerful. Stories and data is a game changer. During COVID, our response was guided by data. We saw in case numbers that rural, Black, Latinx, and American Indian communities were disproportionately affected. Before vaccines were available, we worked to distribute information in those communities. We translated our wear, wait, wash guidance into Spanish, and I still see posters hanging in community centers today. That's wash your hands, wear a mask, and wait 6 feet for those of you that have tried to put that behind you. We worked with migrant farmers and congregate settings and on and on and on to focus on specific zip codes where we knew there was need. And when vaccines arrived, we were able to step up our distribution in state-run vaccination sites using that data. We used the data to keep us laser-focused on where needs needed to be met. We had community organization leaders, tribal leaders, and community health workers in the field, answering questions and making people comfortable about getting a vaccine. And in the very first few months, we erased or narrowed the gaps that we saw among groups. Our Latinx community ended up being vaccinated at a higher rate than our non-Hispanic community. And in many age groups, they still are. Specific age groups within our Black population exceeded vaccination rate of their white and non-white peers. From these capabilities built during the pandemic, we are implementing new programs every day in North Carolina, committed to equity, moving both fast and fair. That, in 250 words or less, is how you infuse equity into a situation. Your courses have taught you all these principles. You have put them to work, and you will in your clinical experience. You will integrate them into your advocacy topics. You constructed your final doctoral projects to infuse the system with more equity and inclusion for better outcomes for everyone. I hope that you can see yourself in each of these priorities, and as one of the bearers of the torch of equity, that must light everything we do to improve health for North Carolinians. And if you think that these big ideas are a stretch for your career, let me tell you just a few quick stories. I told you that my winding career thing would come back. Cheryl Franklin is a nursing eye care consultant in our Greenville district office. She took this job 11 years ago because she couldn't think of anything better than helping people with low vision issues see better. Nursing school and a series of traditional nursing jobs prepared her, she said, but she's also learned about assistive devices and matching those to a person's environment. Of her work, she says, there are so many aha moments. I feel like I'm lifting them and really making a difference. How important do you think seeing better is for everyday tasks to mental health? Or Ryan Jury, a former emergency department nurse who got a little frustrated with the system. He worked in community health centers for a few years, at which point he went back to school to get his MBA. And with his MBA, he learned about how to bridge clinical and administrative priorities. Does that sound familiar? He was working in public health during COVID and was one of several vaccine wranglers we had at the department who kept track of regulation, refrigeration, and many other details that didn't rhyme. As we got vaccines to areas of high poverty in communities that didn't speak much English and to people who didn't have a primary care provider, and he's now on board as our assistant division director for operational excellence at the Division of Public Health. How much equity will this nurse instill in the public health systems of our future? I can go on. Nurses at the Department of Health and Human Services might be inspectors, making sure that patients in hospitals, people living in long-term care facilities, or people using home health agencies get the highest quality of care. They review and approve curricula for certified nurse aid programs across the state. One runs the communicable disease branch, and one, Susan Little, is our chief public health nursing officer. She practiced as a public health nurse at the local, state, national, and even international levels. She's worked on everything from high-risk pregnancies to tuberculosis. She also spent some time in the Peace Corps and joined us 11 years ago, working as a consultant before moving into management. Oh, and at some point during her long career, she went back to school to get her Doctor of Nursing Practice. Guess where? Susan continues to work with Doosan and your many community programs. 3 years ago, she was awarded the Trailblazer Alumna Award. How many North Carolinians' safety, health, and well-being will be improved by her work? These priorities are a launching point, and there is no stronger place for us to start than expanding Medicaid. Every month that goes by, we lose out on $521 million for North Carolina, dollars at no cost to the state taxpayer. Imagine the access folks would have to mental health care, to the management of their chronic diseases, to the availability of rural workforce, to giving each of you more options for employment and shoring up our strong and inclusive workforce. I hope that as you start your careers, North Carolina will finally rise to the larger calling of health and well-being for our state. Now is the time. So whatever path you are embarking on today, I want you to remember that you are making a difference. You're uniquely trained and equipped to make this vision, my vision, your vision, a reality. I cannot wait to see what you do next. Hopefully, in many years, I'll be doing a graduation speech and I will reference one of you. You can start with your neighborhood or North Carolina. You can go somewhere else, but I wouldn't advise it. Wherever you choose, this is your opportunity. Seize it and change someone's world. Thank you. Congratulations.
Thank you, Secretary Kingsley, for being with us here today and for your inspiring address about the role of nurses in responding to some of the most pressing health and social welfare challenges facing North Carolinians. Your comments provide reinforcement for the path that our school has taken in advancing health equity and social justice through our transformative nursing education, practice, and research. At the Duke University School of Nursing, we share your vision for improving health and well-being for all North Carolinians. And the Duke University School of Nursing is committed to making this shared vision a reality. Once again, thank you for being with us today, Secretary Kingsley. Another round of applause for our secretary. I would now like to recognize Dr. Mary Ann Fuchs, Vice President of Patient Care and System Chief Nurse Executive for the Duke University Health System, an academic health system providing services across many sites that spans the full continuum of care. Dr. Fuchs is also the Associate Dean of Clinical Affairs for the Duke University School of Nursing. After over two decades as our chief nursing leader and 40 years at Duke, she will be concluding her tenure as Vice President of Patient Care and System Chief Nurse Executive at the end of this year. I would like to organize my recognition of Dr. Fuchs around her contributions in three major areas: the Duke University Health System, the Duke University School of Nursing, and finally, the broader nursing profession. First, as Vice President of Patient Care and System Chief Nurse Executive for the Duke University Health System, Dr. Fuchs is responsible for ensuring excellence in the standard of nursing practice across all clinical settings. As a member of the Health System Executive Team, Dr. Fuchs supports and facilitates an interdisciplinary team approach to the delivery of care. This includes creating an environment in which collaboration is valued and excellence in practice, education, and research are promoted and achieved. To illustrate the breadth and depth of the areas Dr. Fuchs provides leadership for, I'd like to highlight just a few. Dr. Fuchs provides leadership for Duke home care, infusion and hospice services, education services, care coordination and management, accreditation, regulatory affairs, and centralized nursing services such as flexible staffing and staff promotion programs. Dr. Fuchs also leads the Duke University Health System Friends of Nursing Program, an endowed program for the recognition of excellence and professional development of nurses. Second, here at the Duke University School of Nursing, Dr. Fuchs has never hesitated to provide her knowledge and expertise to the students within all of our academic programs. Often serving as a speaker for our student program events, teaching about nursing and executive leadership, and co-directing the Duke Advancement of Nursing Center of Excellence Dance, a partnership between the Duke University Health System and the Duke University School of Nursing to match the clinical expertise and needs of the Duke University Health System with the research and academic expertise of the Duke University School of Nursing. Her connection to the Duke University School of Nursing isn't just as part of our faculty. Dr. Fuchs is also a proud alumnus, having earned a master's degree in oncology nursing, a postmaster's certificate in education, and a doctorate in nursing practice, all from the Duke University School of Nursing. Third, in terms of her contributions to the broader nursing profession, Dr. Fuchs has served in numerous national leadership roles. For example, Dr. Fuchs served as the president of the American Organization for Nursing Leadership, AONL. In this role, Dr. Fuchs inspired nurse leaders during the COVID-19 pandemic, completed a longitudinal study to understand the impact of the pandemic on nurse leaders, and finished her tenure as president by co-leading with American Organization for Nursing Leadership CEO Robin Begley the development of the AONL 2022-2024 strategic plan. In addition, Dr. Fuchs served as a member of the American Hospital Association, AHA, Task Force on COVID-19 Pathways to Recovery, served as the board chair for the Center for Child and Family Health in Durham, North Carolina, is a fellow in the American Academy of Nursing, is a fellow in the Warden Fellows Program in Management for Nurse Executives, and is a Robert Wood Johnson Executive Nurse Fellow. These are only a small portion of Dr. Fuchs' many, many, many accomplishments as a nursing leader. In January of 2023, Dr. Fuchs will continue to advocate to support healthcare organizations, frontline team members, and the nursing profession as a member of the American Hospital Association's Board of Trustees, a role customarily only held by individuals who truly exemplify leadership in healthcare. I am delighted to share that Dr. Fuchs will remain meaningfully engaged in the Duke University School of Nursing in supporting our vision for the future of healthcare and the nursing profession. Dr. Fuchs, on behalf of the Duke University School of Nursing, I'd like to present you with this award for your commitment to the Duke University Health System, the Duke University School of Nursing, and the nursing profession overall. Will you please join me at the center podium, Dr. Fuchs? Dr. Fuchs, with our greatest appreciation, we hereby present you with this award in recognition for your impact on the nursing profession, the Duke University Health System, and the Duke University School of Nursing for more than 40 years. We appreciate and celebrate your unwavering commitment to excellence in transforming nursing practice, leadership, and advocacy.
Thank you so much. Thank you. So while this is a surprise, I did not expect this. So thank you so much, Dean Ramos and the faculty, for your leadership and the opportunity to speak this morning. I thought I was just given a couple of words. So first, congratulations to all the graduates here. You've completed an incredible, important milestone in your career. And special thanks to all your families, friends, colleagues, and the faculty who are here for this special celebration. So as you know, I've been a nurse for 40 years. So think about that. Where do you want to be in 40 years, and what do you want to have accomplished? I've got so many stories to tell that I won't tell them today, but I do remember when we didn't have cell phones, computers, email, and infusion pumps were only for certain drugs in the ICU. How the times have changed. I've had an incredible career, and I've served in many different roles. And I arrived at Duke in 1982, and I know many of you weren't even born. but at a time of massive growth and change. Now we have new schools, clinics, hospitals, not just here, but in many counties across North Carolina, and we serve the country and the world. And we continue to change every day. I was a new grad, wanted to be a MICU nurse, but I fell in love with oncology patients. Never assume your choice today is your final choice. There are so many options available to you. I was going to stay 2 years and go because that's what young nurses did, and they got Duke experience and could go anywhere, but I didn't. I truly found that there are opportunities for a lifetime here at Duke or in North Carolina, as you hear from Speaker Kinsley. Look for those opportunities. They are here. I've had the opportunity to grow as a leader, to build upon leadership roles, and have some great mentors. Find your mentors. They will help you tremendously. I've had the honor of laying the foundation for our, at that time, our bone marrow transplant program. I helped to lead phase 1 through 4 clinical research studies, foundational studies of several growth factors today that have turned into standard therapies for oncology patients, massively improving their course of care. All the while, you heard, I completed 2 degrees and a postmaster's certificate at Doosan. Incredible experiences. Remember, we're all lifelong learners. I've precepted countless graduate students, and I've taught in our schools in addition. And that's the uniqueness of Duke. Serving multiple missions, the opportunities are truly endless, and they were endless for me. And if you must know, I never, ever had a personal goal of becoming a chief nurse. But yet I've done that for now, I don't know how many years. Since 1999, I was asked to serve first as the chief nurse for Duke University Hospital. At a time when we were growing the health system, my role quickly expanded. It was a very contentious time with tremendous change and tremendous growth. I've had good times and I've had bad times, but from this, I've taken those learnings to continuously improve the experiences of the people we serve, patients, families, staff, students, and our community. And I am proud. I am so proud of the accomplishments and the colleagues who are at the core of this success, because success takes a team, and it is in that team relationship that you will find you can accomplish great things. And one such accomplishment for Duke was Magnet designation, which is an international program that recognizes the quality of care that's delivered by nurses in hospitals across our country, across the world, around the world now. The basis is all around every nurse is a leader, and the principles of transformational leadership are instilled in each and every one. That excellent, exceptional clinical practice is always maintained and high quality care is delivered. That there are system structures, processes, procedures for staff to be able to continue to flourish, to grow and develop, and that the environment is one that's supportive of practice. That we learn through new knowledge, research, and innovation led by nurses, all driving incredible clinical outcomes. It's about continuous improvement, which is what I believe we at Duke, no matter where you are at Duke, are all about. And it's about the support and dedication of leaders to improving our patients and staff experience, focusing on delivering excellence in all we do. So during my time as a chief nurse, I always felt supported to serve in many ways, both internal and external to Duke. You've heard some about that. We've had many accomplishments, especially in the partnership with the School of Nursing. And I want to give you one example. We were included as one of 5 institutions in the United States to participate in a Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Innovation Project that greatly increased the number of nurse practitioner graduates across the United States. This model for graduate nurse education needs to be considered and should be considered by our state and federal governments to expand our ability to deliver health care. As a chief nurse, I was supported and elected, as you heard, as the president of the American Organization for Nursing Leadership, a subsidiary of the Hospital Association. And this was during the pandemic. You heard a lot more before about the pandemic. You experienced the pandemic, and really no words can adequately thank everyone for the incredible response of all team members during the pandemic. It was a time, and is continues to be a time, that highlights and recognizes the value and impact that nurses provide every single day. And while I could go on and describe those accomplishments, they're not my accomplishments, but the accomplishments of an incredible Duke nursing team. And I'm so proud of the impactful work that's been completed and will continue. So in my career, I've been surrounded by the excellence of Duke nursing. In fact, our strategy assures that Duke nurses set the standard and deliver practice excellence. We do that through continuous learning, innovation, advocacy, academic practice partnerships, and dissemination of new knowledge. Duke nurses foster a culture that's inclusive, diverse, equitable, where all members feel they belong. Duke nurses drive effective systems of care to deliver seamless care. And Duke nurses provide remarkable care to all. To all. There are so many challenges ahead in healthcare that nursing can lead and help to solve, and I could go on about those ideas today, but I think I'm going to leave that to the future work I will do as the executive advisor to the Chancellor and the CEO of Duke, and as well as I join the American Hospital Association as the first nurse selected to serve as an at-large trustee. So, so you might say, so why so many personal examples? It's because I'm a Duke nurse. You are a Duke nurse. We are all Duke nurses, and the world is depending upon us. My best to each of you as you embark on your incredible careers. Thank you.
Wow, thank you, Dr. Fuchs. You certainly are a model and a stellar exemplar of a Doosan graduate, improving healthcare and advancing the nursing profession. It is now my pleasure to invite our student speaker today, Ms. Irma Arnice Stern, to the stage. Arnice, on behalf of the Duke University School of Nursing, it is my pleasure to present you with this medallion in recognition of your important role in today's ceremony.
Good morning. I thank God, my family and friends, and each of you today for this opportunity to stand before you. I'd like to thank Duke University School of Nursing because healing occurs in those walls and angels walk those halls. We just happen to call them faculty. Dean Ramos, faculty, my committee chair, Dr. Marion Broom, my committee members, Drs. Barbara Turner and Mary Ann Fuchs, thank you all for your uncompromising standards of excellence and the intellectual investments that you've made into us academically and as individuals. On behalf of this class, these classes, I'd like to give special thanks to our family and friends for your unwavering love, support, and patience. I will talk about resilience and advancing our dreams for the next few moments. Resilience is the ability to bounce back when things don't go as planned. And we've all had experiences, times, and events when things did not go as planned. However, resilient people utilize their resources, strengths, and skills to overcome challenges and work through life setbacks to actualize their dreams. Greg Kincaid said, "No matter how much falls on us, we keep plowing ahead. That's the only way to keep the roads clear." Fellow graduates, to get to this day through a global crises, we plowed ahead. We all looked into the face of a global pandemic and said, this seems like a good time for me to advance my dreams. And we kept the roads very clear because we then said, and I think I will advance this dream at one of the top nursing universities in the United States. And due to COVID-19, many of us fulfilled our dreams while learning under extreme conditions. Many of us were forced to shift to online learning, which was unfamiliar to some of us. Many of us were trying to complete coursework while we were recovering from COVID. Many of us had to care for loved ones who had COVID or to grieve those that we ourselves had lost to the virus. We were completing homework assignments after long, hazardous, and physically and emotionally exhausted work days. Nursing contributions were made at all levels during the pandemic. We may not have shown up on the same ships, but we all ended up in the same harbor. We were serving with limited PPE or protective wear. We were supporting frustrated families that were isolated from their loved ones, administering COVID testing outdoors, sometimes in the cold and even in the rain. We provided access to vaccines for vulnerable populations. We continued impacting patients' lives. Whether our patients survived or not, we impacted their lives. And because the pandemic is not over, we continue and are still impacting lives today. If we think about it, everyone sitting here today demonstrated some level of resilience, and we grew in some way during the COVID-19 pandemic experience. Preparing for this speech forced me to reflect upon and to try to understand why is it that I am so passionate about resilience and advancing your dreams. You see, I have not always been what you see standing here before you today. I am educated, but I am also a product of my environment and my experiences. I grew up financially poor, a country girl from Palestine, Texas. My single mother struggled to provide the necessities of life while my dad was managing his own struggles. I am familiar with government assistance programs, and I've survived the traumas, tragedies, abuses, the crimes, and social determinants that typically impact and cause poor outcomes. I have benefited from a lot of resources and wonderful people who have saw some potential in me that while I was growing up, I could have never recognized in myself. I've had the opportunity to work at one of the COVID-19 alternative care sites, which were specialty hospitals that only cared for COVID-19 patients. I had the opportunity to work with Dr. Denton Cooley, the surgeon that implanted the first total artificial heart transplant in the United States. I have held some titles at some top-tier organizations that some of you might find impressive. I've also been recognized as a top woman nurse leader nationally. But interestingly, I was grappling with tremendous work stressors, and my overall mental health, while the world around me was praising me for how wonderful they saw me to be. As we advance our dream, external successes does not always reflect internal struggles. People who demonstrate resilience do not experience less distress, less grief, or anxiety than others. However, they do use healthy coping skills to handle such difficulties. They possess the resilience to rebound and remain calm in the face of adverse childhood experiences, natural disasters, wars, racially and gender motivated violence, economic setbacks, political unrest, and even a pandemic. I had a boss that would say, "Arnice, never let a good crisis go to waste." Resilience takes intentionality. It does not occur by happenstance. It is built by finding your purpose, believing in yourself, and for those of you who are like me, trust and believe those that believe in you. Developing a social network, embracing change, being optimistic, nurture yourself, continually develop problem-solving skills, make your dreams a priority, establish goals, taking actions, and committing to just building over time. Even those of us who demonstrate resilience, we need support, our families, our friends, our heroes. A key to resilience is knowing when to seek support and assistance. Managing stress is a skill, and prioritizing your dreams is an art. Peer nurses, there will be demands from the workplace, staffing shortages, there will be managers and money tempting you to work extra shifts or to accept promotions that you may not actually be prepared for. While you might be thinking, you know what, I really want to go ahead and get my BSN, my MSN, my DNP, or my PhD. Consider that those things may be distractors from further deferring your dream. Perhaps your dream isn't related to academics. All dreams are big dreams. That's the nature of a dream. Focus and advance those dreams. And I can say from experience, it's not easy. Practicing resiliency is hard, yet it is mandatory for the advancement of dreams. Nelson Mandela said, "Don't judge me by my success. Judge me by how many times I fell down and got back up again." Get back up from whatever setbacks that you may face. Life is not a rehearsal. We don't get a practice run. Be unstoppable, because this is it. Advance your dreams, and advance them starting right now.
Thank you so much, Arnise, for being with us here today, for your reflections on resilience, and for helping us to think about our dreams and aspirations. I think it's a good moment to pause. Those were very, very powerful words, Arnise, and I think that they resonate with many of us. I think particularly what you said about, judge me by what happens after I fall and get back up again. And so keep that in mind for everyone that's here today. It's a very, very important message. Thank you. As we move to the presentation of graduates, I invite Dr. Valerie Sable, Vice Dean for Academic Affairs and professor here at the Duke University School of Nursing, to come and recognize the students earning their Doctor of Nursing Practice, Masters of Science in Nursing, certificate awardees, and accelerated Bachelor of Science in Nursing degrees.
Thank you, Dean Ramos. It is my pleasure to present the graduates for the Doctor of Nursing Practice degree. These graduates have been prepared to lead in the health system of the future. They will evaluate current practices, looking for opportunities for improvement, and will bring solutions to gaps in care. Each DNP graduate will come forward and be hooded by Dr. Julie Waldrop, Assistant Dean of the DNP program, and also by the chair of their scholarly project. Please hold your applause until all DNP graduates have been recognized. Irma Arnice Stern. Congratulations, Dr. Stern. Kelsey Thompson. Congratulations, Dr. Thompson. Ronisha Diana Baldwin. Congratulations, Dr. Baldwin. Kate Feely Lynch. Congratulations, Dr. Feely Lynch. Angela Chang Chu. Congratulations, Dr. Chu. Anne-Marie Genetasio. Congratulations, Dr. Genetasio. Meredith Allen Carr. Congratulations, Dr. Carr. Cassidy McRory. Congratulations, Dr. McRory. Carrie Overstreet. Congratulations, Dr. Overstreet. Nichelle Salazar. Congratulations, Dr. Salazar. Enrique Adebong. Congratulations, Dr. Adebong. Carrie Keys Young. Congratulations, Dr. Young. Tanya Barcinas. Congratulations, Dr. Barcinas. Dolly Marie Furr. Congratulations, Dr. Furr. Hugh C. Davis. Congratulations, Dr. Davis. Maritza Ruiz. Congratulations, Dr. Ruiz. Jessica Small Jarvis. Congratulations, Dr. Jarvis. Carolyn Beatty, that's me. Congratulations, Dr. Beatty. Whitney Messer Abel. Congratulations, Dr. Abel. Daria Hansen. Congratulations, Dr. Hansen. Trisha Duru. Congratulations, Dr. Duru. Catherine Lasitra. Congratulations, Dr. LaCitra. Anthony Paverini. Congratulations, Dr. Paverini. Dawn Miller. Congratulations, Dr. Miller. Jason Paul Kuchera. Congratulations, Dr. Kuchera. That's it. That concludes the hooding of our DNP graduates. Congratulations. It is now my pleasure to present the graduates for the Masters of Science in Nursing and Certificate awardees. These remarkable graduates are prepared to deliver exemplary healthcare as advanced practice nurses and as leaders and innovators within our healthcare systems across our nation and around the globe. They will serve as role models and educators to nurses, health professionals, and students of the future. Graduates will be greeted by Dr. Ann Derwin, Assistant Dean of the MSN program and also the lead faculty member of the major. Please hold your applause until all MSN graduates and certificate awardees have been recognized. Victoria Andrews. Allison Mazzi. Elizabeth Benedict. Aaron Bullman. Alyssa Cobb. Molly Eddins. Veronica Herndon. Callie Rogers Johnson. Christy McCoy Martzoff. Haley Laura Mock. Thank you. Jennifer Eugen Pang. Danielle Picard. Courtney Starwalt. Kathy Wanajit. Congratulations. Teresa Yum. Congratulations. Victoria Atker. Victoria Alicia Averill. New name. Congratulations. Casey Kamelik. Alyssa Marie Dungo. Vida Jamfi. Pimentel Khan. Congratulations. It's my pleasure. I'm so proud. Brittany Lane. Miranda Ritz.
Congratulations, Miranda. We're so proud of you.
Michelle Benida.
Yes, Michelle. Congratulations. Proud of you.
Claudia Willett. Margaret Dancy. Catherine Desarden.
Katie, I'm so glad you're staying in your life with us.
Joan Curie.
Congratulations, Joan.
Samantha Perdue. Olivia Polisi.
Congratulations.
Colleen Gagnon. Caitlin Tebow.
Congratulations, Caitlin.
Huh? Baji. Christina Baji. Lauren Ashby. Nisreen Atta.
Congratulations. We're so happy.
Farah Billa.
Congratulations.
Austin Desarden.
Great job, Austin. Congratulations.
Taylor English.
Congratulations, Taylor.
Larissa Fernandez. Heather Hancock.
Congratulations, Heather.
Shelby Diane Holloway.
Congratulations, Shelby.
Ashley Kara Howell.
Congratulations, Ashley.
Jeffrey Kapanyas.
Congratulations, Jeffrey.
Madeline Schobeck. Kaylee Wilson.
Awesome, Kaylee. Congratulations.
Victoria Kester. Anna Giselle Laquata. Maheen Moyne. April Ross. Jonathan Santos.
Congratulations, Jonathan.
Michael Swartwood. Hunter Bulby. Christiana Ray. Olivia Burkholler. Haley Church. Madeline Collins.
Congratulations. We're so proud of you.
Carrie Andara. Tracy Ferris.
Tracy, so proud of you. I'm honored to work with you.
Sarah Fiddler. Jordan Frash.
Oh my gosh.
Bailey Gibbons. Serene Sophia Hussein.
Serene, so, so proud of you.
Soleil Chanel Jones. Kelsey Kaylor. Ella Little.
Yes, Ella. Superstar.
Erica Christine Lofton. Raquel Morado.
Congratulations, Raquel. I'm so proud of you.
Laura Nguyen. Jessica Oldroyd.
Yeah, Jessica. Jessica.
Erin Marie Pollock. Scott.
All right, Bree, let's go get it.
Lisa Joanna Staccato. Lena Varghese.
Yes, so
Lee Robeson Allred. Elizabeth Kimley Bonner.
Congratulations. I'm so proud of you. Oh,
Julia Delgatti Batiste. Emily Frank. Taylor Hensley. Grace Hopkins.
Great job, Grace. Congratulations.
Sarah Lopez Walters. Joe Nocito.
Amazing you. We're so proud of you. Truly, truly.
Megan Reyes. Nicole Auerenheimer. Bria Bradley.
Congratulations, Bria. Proud of you.
Lindsay Ann Brookmeyer. Nicole Coley Clifton. D. Cox. Lily Gasparetti. Courtney Goldman.
Courtney, congratulations.
Brittany Johnson.
Brittany, congratulations. Krista
Joyner.
Krista, thanks for being such a star.
Sarah McDonald. Anna Elizabeth Malosnik.
Congratulations, Anna. Congratulations.
Rebecca Ashley Montenegro. Adrian Navarro.
Superstar.
Danielle Samuels St. Cyr. Angela Jerome Wen.
Congratulations, Angela. Congratulations.
Andre Lobach. Jasmine Whitcomb. Delisha White. Raina Tomlinson. Tisha Verghese. Holly Gray. Ramona R. Bassnight, and I would like to say Dr. Bassnight. Dr. Peter Berry. This concludes the recognition of MSN graduates and certificate awardees. Congratulations. It is now my pleasure to begin the presentation of graduates for the Bachelor of Science in Nursing degree. Graduates. Graduates will be greeted by Dr. Michelle Hartman, Assistant Dean of the ABSN program. As each student's name is read, they will be presented with their Duke University School of Nursing pin. This pin serves as a symbolic welcome to the nursing profession and signifies the student's academic program completion achievement. Please hold your applause, if you can, until all ABSN graduates have been recognized. Bria Patrice Allen. Lauren Michelle Aslanian. Maggie Jade Barefoot. Maymuna Berry. Sophia Barter. Armando Bermudez. Blackwood. Hunter Blesser. Marcus Deshaun Bullock. Bronco. I got Luciana Bronco. Luciana Bronco. Kyra Zanae Brown. Livia Campos De Sousa. Alyssa Carlson. Aaliyah Carrington. Zoraida Castro. Elizabeth Ann Seener. Megan Counts. I gotcha. Nia Iman Dades. Madison DeLucas. Isabel Carson DeWitt. Troy Duncan. Colt Dupin. Catherine Elizabeth Duran. Melena Echegaray Gomez. Sophie Forte. Sophia Goodrow. Kristen Marie Henry. Hillary Hernandez. Tamia Nicole Hicks. Thais Jenkins. Michael Jensen. Gabriel Caney. Thank you. Ryan Devontae Lawton. Nina Angeline Lopez. Joseph Lopik. Sydney Lujan. Simone Mack. Sam Mahaney.
Hey, Sam.
Juanita Mano. Sunny Malik. Natalie Mayomi Mark. Ryan Deanna McKinney. Christian Mikkel Meister. Janita Zania Lachey Melvin. Kristen Mills.
This makes me not cry. Congratulations.
Hannah Morris.
Hey, Hannah.
Indira Insia and Katia. Siobhan Norman. Oluwadamilola Oluwadara. Alexis Perry. Alyssa Pless. Chris Kwan. Jason Radulovich. Daniel Joseph Ramirez. Marlena Rawls. Madeline Riley. Brianna Rivers. Lauren Meredith Smith. Kelly Southwick. Allie Tamburini. Elizabeth Tavana. Gwendolyn Tosaris. Tanya Marta Trimmer. Mario A. Velado. Jacqueline Villafana. Sarah Wall. Sydney Brielle Williams. Krista Brianna Wilson.
We needed to simulate this the other day. We got it. Picture
from Sophie Wood. Emily Zhang. This concludes the ABSN pinning. Congratulations. Podium.
That's always the nicest part of the ceremony. It's really why we're all here, and thank you very much again to all of our graduates for all that you've done and all that you will do. Again, a round of applause for everyone. As I look out across the chapel, I can't help but feel proud. Some of you will enter the nursing profession for the first time, while others will step into a new level of your professional journey as nursing leaders. Regardless of where you are in your career, you will leave here as our next generation of healthcare agents of change. It is widely accepted that our country's system of healthcare needs to be reformed. We pay far more for our care than other developed nations, yet we are challenged by higher morbidity and mortality overall, and a widening gap of inequity in who gets care and who doesn't. We must also address the harmful effects of social drivers of health, also known as the social determinants of health, so that we can deliver community and home-based care more aligned with individual and family needs. We need a paradigm shift in healthcare. This means a new model of healthcare delivery that is patient-centric, focuses on health promotion and prevention, and disrupts the trajectory of illness and the progression of disease. If we transformed our healthcare system with these elements, it would deliver better outcomes at lower cost than our current system. Nursing and Doosan hold the key to such a transformation. That is why Doosan embarked on a collective and deliberative process, asked the school to reimagine our mission to address these pressing issues in healthcare. I am proud to recite our school's new mission. We at the Duke University School of Nursing advance health equity and social justice by preparing nurse leaders and innovators with a commitment to improving health outcomes through transformative excellence in education, clinical practice, and nursing science. We are recommitting to advancing health equity and embracing social justice in our academic, clinical, and research programs. Our new mission and focus is a bold step towards shifting the paradigm. It's our blueprint for reducing excessive morbidity and premature mortality, for addressing the inequitable distribution of resources, and effectively mitigating the harmful social determinants of health. Graduates, as you transition from your nursing education at Doosan, I hope that you will proudly and boldly take a stance as nurses to shift the paradigm so that we can continue to improve clinical outcomes, increase healthcare accessibility, and reduce costs. As Doosan alumni, your experiences, training, education, values, and purpose prepare you to go out into the world and share your stories, advocate for your patients and the broader nursing profession, innovate healthcare delivery, and embrace health equity and social justice in all aspects of your work. Today is a beautiful commemoration of your commitment, discipline, and accomplishments. We invite you to stay connected to your mentors, faculty, peers, and staff who have made a difference during your time here at the school. Once again, on behalf of the entire Doosan community, I congratulate all of our 2022 winter graduates and wish you all success and happiness in your nursing careers. I invite you to rise as the Nightingales perform the Duke University alma mater. After the conclusion of the alma mater, please remain standing for our graduate and faculty recessional. I ask you to please wait to exit the chapel until the recessional is completed. Thank you very much.